Я так понимаю, что мы приняли демократическое решение провести эту панель на английском языке.
As you wish.
As I wish. Okay. So we will probably switch into English.
That's really good of you. Thank you.
Kevin, London presenters here, and Steve, thank you for coming. Really. Before we start, I will present well-known speakers of the panel, but still it's worth reminding all of us. So from left to right, you see Anastasia Belyanina, who is Managing Director of Investor Relations at the biggest Russian company and one of the most liquid, Sberbank. And thanks for coming.
I tried.
Yes, exactly. We strongly appreciate. It might not have been easy, but excellent having you here. So then we move to AM Communication. We have Sam here, coming specifically from London at a very random recent call. So it was some struggling for you, but thanks for coming. So AM is well known on the market, and I think we will be having a lot of questions to you, specifically on Asia and social media and a lot of our stuff. We have Managing Director of the Moscow Exchange, Anna Vasilenko, here, present, in the middle of the panel. There was no struggle. Excellent, nice summer in Moscow, no rains, so it was a nice walk probably from the Moscow Exchange, which is not far. We have Alexandra Falkova, who is a representative of Sberbank Asset Management, so we have two representatives of different parts of Sberbank in the room. I think that will help us to get a very complex understanding of what's happening on the financial market. We also have Michael Russell from Citygate, also coming from London. Thank you very much for this, traveling to Moscow. We have prepared good weather for you. And I think no need to present Steve, who has been many years in Russia and running Extel, this excellent survey, which is now covering more than 1 million people. I was impressed with the figure. Never assumed. It's just amazing, you know. It's interesting to see how many investor relations professionals in the world, probably less than the number of people who voted.
Definitely in terms of IR professionals, yes.
So it's amazing. So we are small, but a lot of people are watching us. So it's nice to hear. And we'll be definitely referring to your study and to other things as well. So a bit to warm up, maybe we start a bit with the macro and things happening on the Russian stock market and global markets, developed markets, emerging markets as a whole. And then we move to Asia, not flying, but just talking about Asia. And then talking about investor relations with very niche, detailed questions, how to treat investor relations, what are the KPIs, what are the trends, where the next career moves. So that all will be discussed and definitely we'll be taking questions from the room. So talking about macro, it has been volatile. I think everyone is used to hearing this word volatile, unstable, disruptions. I mean, it's a new normal probably. We are living and will be always living maybe. It's not like a short-term period of time. And for Russia specifically, that has been a difficult time because of the commodity prices, because of the sanctions, because of a lot of other stuff. At the same time, however, we are seeing new issues on the Moscow Stock Exchange. And in London as well. So we are seeing companies after 2 years of doing nothing, basically a lazy investor relations job, just sitting doing other stuff, as Steve showed, strategy, other stuff, which is not typical for pan-European companies. But in Russia, we had to adapt, be agile, use Scrum, as Sberbank is teaching us. So we should be, you know, adapting to the environment. So Anna, maybe I start with you. How are you seeing the market right now? Is it some green shoots on the Russian financial market? What's the hope for investor relations? And then my next question would be again to you, what the Moscow Exchange is doing for investor relations? How it can help us? Thank you. Okay.
In terms of the deals, this year, I would say that we have a rather active year. As you might heard, it was the first privatization over last 3 years done literally yesterday. It was a few weeks ago. We had a 52.2 billion ruble deal on the MOEX, which is Alrosa deal. It was not an easy time for the syndicate to take this decision and to actually do the transaction, because it was, I think, about 2 weeks after the Brexit was announced. And I think that it was a very brave move both for the Russian government and for the company and for the syndicate to do a deal in such a challenging time. But to find a good window, and I think that the deal has a tremendous success if we compare it to the situation which we had before. First of all, the discount was small. It was around 5%. Second, the deal size was enormous. It was roughly $800 million. And in the last 3 years, it was the second deal that size. And the first one was Alrosa 3 years ago. I would say that we hope to have more companies, but I don't expect any big privatization placement this year anymore. We would probably have another deal which was actually announced to the market publicly, which was Rosneft. They are working on the deal. We don't have the day-to-day interaction with the team, so I don't know the progress. But their shareholders and management, they were saying that they are keen to do the deal this year, and the size was roughly about the same as Alrosa. So I think that they don't have investor relations team yet. So if we're talking about career opportunity, this is definitely the one. In terms of the smaller deals, I would say that we have a different trend now on the market. And the trend is to have the deals on the Russian market only, and not to have international prospectus and do a placement only to the local investors. We could say that this is really a trend for the last 2 years. So last year we had Moscow Credit Bank, which actually did IPO and SPO. We had OVK, the company which called Novorossiysky Kombinat Хлебопродуктов, which is actually a grain terminal company, part of the Summa assets, and also partially owned by the government. We also had two other deals, which was actually bigger deals, and which was secondary deals, Lente and Magnit. But they were like a secondary placement. There was a proper SPO with an international book. So in terms of the talking of this Russian only deals, I would say that we would see that those deals are usually not very big. They usually up to 10 billion rubles. They usually have a big amount of pension money invested, and it not necessarily says that the deal was not a market deal, because it usually have a research report, it usually have some roadshow done in Russia, but those deals are placed with the just a small number of investors. So talking about the current year, we had SPO of OVK, we had the Promsvyaz, and we had a few bigger deals as well, which is, as I mentioned, Alrosa, which was Moscow Exchange. It was an SPO for 10 billion ruble. And it was also Rusagra, which was the deal done in, mostly in London, even though the company has a listing with MOEX as well. So I probably bored you with the facts which you partially know, and
not at all. I think impressed with the number of listings. So I mean, it's alive.
We really had a lot of things to do those 2 years, especially in 2015. 2015 and October, November, we were having deals pretty much every week. And it's actually a good companies. I like the company. I like the Novorossiysky Kombinat Хлебопродуктов business. They have a very high dividend yield.
We're paying a lot to the shareholders. We also have the export, export internal, you know, benefits in the current market. I really like Объединенные вагонные компании. It's an actually innovative company who have the, who actually reinvented the U.S. Railway wagon, which is quite good, and they have an ambition to change the whole railway industry by their products. So this is basically the cases. We also have the Europlan, which is a small leasing company, which also has a very, very impressive numbers. They have a EBITDA margin 23%. Impressive for the financial market. I'm sure Anastasia would love to have this figure in their reports. But this is a smaller, much smaller business. That's why for them it's easy to get such results. So moving to your second question, what Moscow Exchange doing for IR community, a part of sponsoring this event, we also doing a lot of things. First of all, we launch a new format of our MOEX forum conferences. First, we tried in December last year. We were actually pretty, I would say, scared because we was doing it for the first time. We had a lot of discussion both internally and externally, but we decided that we have to do this because for now it's very difficult for mid-cap Russian companies and for some companies who has a sanction elements in their agenda to have a good roadshow schedule and to have a lot of attention from investors. This was the reason why we include into our conferences one-on-one format. First time we tried in London, we have 23 companies. Thank you for the companies which came to London who support us. It was the most of the large cap and was also a few mid-cap companies. I think they were all happy with the agenda, except some banks, which was unfortunate, but it's a really tough situation in the banking sector, and the mid-cap banks is really not very that attractive for the international investors. Then we try this in Moscow in April. In Moscow, we have 43 companies. I think that probably some of you was not that happy with the schedule because most of the investors in the schedule was from Russia. We have a few international investors. We have one company from South Africa, which was the first, you know, visit to Russia. And I think that the company who met them was very happy to have a new prospective investor. And I would say that we will try to continue this trend. We will definitely do another two conferences this year, one in New York and one in London. We are invited all of you to participate. We will push investment banks hard to deliver you very promising, fulfilled, and busy schedule. I could not announce the date yet, but most likely the New York forum will be in the mid November, and London forum will be in the first week of December. So please join us for those events, and I'm sure we could work together to help you to reach the international investor community. This is actually the biggest thing you're doing. The smaller thing which we are doing is, first of all, you're all welcome to come to Moscow Exchange with your Investor Day. We are not a hotel, so we won't charge you. So you could use our premises. We have a very nice hall. It's not as beautifully decorated as this one, but I think the view is better. And a few companies actually did the Investor Day with us, like Rosgidro, for example. They plan to do another one soon. So we invite you all, if you need an Investor Day and if you want to stay from the hotel, please feel free to contact either Victoria or Pavel Popov or David Pipe from my team. So we are very happy to help you with that. So the third thing which we're doing, I'm sorry, I'm probably taking too much time, is we're planning to do a special conference for IR in September. We would like to, we had one 2 years ago while we invited the investor relation servicing company, which doing, you know, roadshow, which doing perception studies, which doing shareholder ID. We also wanted to ask innovation company to come. We invited Steve, of course, to join us, and M Communications. We would do something in October, September. Please feel free to give us your idea what you are interested about. There is one thing which we'll definitely cover, which is GRI. I think that we as an exchange get a lot of criticism from our colleagues and from the funds who are actually doing SGRI, that we don't have the respective indices, that we don't have enough attention of the Russian company to this subject. We were kind of feeling that probably it's not the top priority for IR at the current environment. But I think that it needs to be looked anyway, and especially year on year, we get more and more questions about this. So we would definitely cover this subject. And last but not least, we have the annual report content in November the 8th. While everybody, again, welcome to send us your annual reports for the review. And as last year, we will be doing the expert committee reports for the shortlisted company. So the 40 company which will be in the shortlist will get a detailed reports about their annual report content. So it will be about corporate governance, strategy, the overall information disclosure, also SGRI and in other subjects. So please participate, please send us your annual reports, please come to the ceremony, and we will give you the detailed report back if you will be lucky to get to the shortlist. And we will also have a follow-up event in the next few days to discuss the best annual reports. So, sorry for keeping you long.
No,
if you have any questions, please feel free.
It was excellent because it was you're doing so much, and I can only add to that that I am happy to be part of the issues committee of the Moscow Exchange you are heading and which you launched several years ago. And I will remind you, it's just a great platform to convey the message of the companies to the regulator through the stock exchange, because separate companies can really go to the central bank, to other, I mean, administrations and regulators. But separately, we can't achieve more. But for the Moscow Exchange, we achieve a combined position, and we have delivered a lot of things, right, in the recent 2 years, which impacted the decision making in the legislation and other formats. Right?
Absolutely. So, and one of those decisions was actually prolonging the transformation period for the new listing reform system. So as you might remember, we launched a listing reform 2 years ago, and we combined 6 lists to the 3 lists. And for the first level of listing, we had a lot of new requirements, especially related to the corporate governance, which are quite sophisticated, I would say. And while all the companies who was in the listing committee was pushing very hard us and regulators to give them this shareholder meeting season to re-elect their boards in order to have enough independent directors on their boards. So this was the one of the, I would say, tangible achievement of this committee. And the other one was for some companies, it was a minor involvement of the directors with the company activity, which doesn't let company to count this director independent. This was also possible after the companies pushed it through investor committee. Issuer committee. So please feel free again to be elected. We'll have a new election process in March. I think that it's more for corporate secretaries and people who are involved in the information disclosure. I mean, the content of the discussion. But if you like to be there, please come over. We will discuss it.
Yeah, thank you. So let's now move to Alexandra, and I have a question on the trends with asset management. How often are you seeing Russian investor relations? What's the clients are requiring? Because with the Russian ruble volatility in recent years, probably most of your clients have opted for investments in hard currencies, maybe beyond Russia, maybe on developed markets, to hedge somehow the Russian ruble risk and Russia risk, right? So how is it right now? Are you seeing clients who wish now to invest in Russia, or is it still the trend, some overseas investments for you?
The trends that we were seeing previous years after the sanctions initiation are still here. Most of our clients are interested in hard currency returns, dollar-denominated assets, but they are eager to have a kind of exposure for, shall we say, both worlds, both emerging markets and developed markets. So now we are trying to structure our portfolios, even if we're talking about mutual fund, which investment structure is mostly Russian companies. For mutual funds, we are also have to look for interesting ideas outside Russia. And for basically the next step in this evolution is to launch launching new funds, new strategies. For example, this year we launched a new strategy, ETF based. It is called Global Industrial Companies. So this could create an opportunity for our investors to split the risks and to invest in interesting industry with that is related both with high dividend yields and potential new technologies that are developed. In terms of potential outlook, for this year, we are more cautious for the Russian market, of course. But as we can see in terms of different sectors' performance, there are some selective themes that our investors try to play out this year. For example, electric utility sector, pure Russian exposure. But the sector was he was not so desired for previous years. And now the new hope for dividends, basically created a huge interest for it. But it is, a big question. Should this hope translate into dividend stream? But
yeah, let's see. On that, it's interesting that the trend is still hard currencies. Do you think, I just have in mind this idea and don't know if it will work in reality, but have you seen any top management announcing that they're targeting some annual dividend amount expressed in US dollars, and they commit, they say, okay, this year we will pay $500 million. It's a Russian company based here, it gets most of its revenues, okay, from different sources, from Russia, from abroad, but it promises to pay something in the range of $400-500 million during the year. Have you seen cases like that? I mean, it's risky for any company to take such a commitment, but probably that will bring investors, because that will give more predictability. You can put in your model $500 million, whatever happens. No?
Well, it's an interesting question. From one side, that is a good thing. I mean, investors are eager to have some kind of guaranteed dividend amount. But we should not split equity and bonds. It's always, if you are investing in equity, you should have a kind of ability to have higher dividend yields in case better company performance.
So all the time you have some upside, and this is what is attracting, as Anastasia mentioned here. What I suggested is basically literally bringing your equity story into fixed income, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Something like that.
Yes.
Okay. Excellent. Thank you. We'll return to you and Anya later in our panel, but now let's very briefly talk about Asia. And I think the right person to tell us what's happening in Asia, is there an Asian potential, are we seeing? We're seeing a lot of Chinese tourists here, but it doesn't help anyhow our financial markets. Well, what's your take, traveling so often, you and Tom? You know, we are seeing all these beautiful pictures in Chinese we can't read so far, but you
Tom and I know that there are certain Russian companies that are definitely eagerly waiting for Asian capital. But having spoken to quite a few Asian investors, we think it might take, they might be waiting a while. But
like 100 years?
Well, it takes time. And if you look at the reaction to the pivot to the east, to, you know, immediately following the Crimea and sanctions, Russia pronounced that we are going to pivot to the east and we're going to be friends with Asia and we will raise capital there. And there's a understandable large amount of skepticism towards those such proclamations. At the same time, if you look a couple of years further back, and you remember how Moscow was actively and continues to actively position itself as a international financial center, there was also a great deal of skepticism about that idea when it first started to be talked about actively. But after years of excellent work by the Moscow Exchange and very hard work to upgrade the infrastructure, to smooth out regulation, to connect to international platforms, they're doing a very good job, and it's starting to happen.
So is it a reality that, let's say, in 15, 10, 20 years from now, you will see Chinese companies listed here in Moscow, and some of us working as investor relations for those branches here in Moscow of the Chinese companies, like Alibaba or someone?
I think that what we're looking at is, or what we need to, first of all, there are already certain deals happening. You had Dietsky Mir, 23% being sold to the Russian and Chinese investment fund. You had 10% of Yamal SPG being sold to the Chinese. You have Vankorneft going to, Rosneft working with the Indians on Vankorneft. And it's hard to say, would these have happened without the pivot to the east, or would they have, happened anyway? That's still difficult to say, but I think that, right now the very clear motivation is why Russia has turned to the east. What's less clear is why is Asia going to be interested in Russia? If you want high risk but high potential income, you can invest in China. You can invest in Africa. If you want something more stable and predictable, you can invest in America or Europe. And so the case for Russia really still needs to be made, and the education about what is the Russian case, what are the Russian companies that I should be looking at, still very much needs to be made. And it starts with at a government level of going out and making the case in Singapore, in China, in India, everywhere. And it takes a lot of work. There are some good examples of who's successful at it now. You have Moskovskaya Birzha doing the Shanghai Forum, I think for the second year this year. You have the Russian Direct Investment Fund that's regularly going out and making the case, but that needs to continue. It needs to be strengthened. Eventually that knowledge and understanding of Russia will come, but it also then will take a lot of effort by the Russian companies themselves, by the issuers, to not just do an NDR every now and then to China or to Singapore, but to really go there, spend some time there, and understand what they need to be bringing to investors, because it's a different, completely different atmosphere. And so, and once that starts to happen, then you can we'll probably see, or we could see, greater activity and the kind of proclamations of the pivot to the East becoming more of a reality. Tom suggested to me that I close with a very important and insightful phrase from Tolstoy, which is "Нет сильнее тех двух войн, время и терпение." And if you work at it and you are patient and you give it time, and probably spend your time in a smart way, then it certainly can happen. And we at EM never fight with Tolstoy's.
Yeah, excellent, excellent. And definitely we will talk about a smarter way in invest relations and relative to Asia. And you mentioned probably you should be backed somehow, related or supported by government organizations or RFPE or the Moscow Exchange when traveling to Asia, because those guys in China are strongly looking at you, not as a private company, but the way you are connected and supported by the government or such structures. It's very important, I understand. But we can talk about it later. So now, kicking off with investor relations, I probably would like to ask a question to Anastasia. So I think everyone was really fascinated with the excellent video of this Sberbank top management team coming from Stanford and sharing with the world their findings with Tesla meetings, the other banks, and the way they're doing. I was at St. Pete Forum. I took a lot of free land books at the stand, of Sberbank on different areas, how to transform anything, and you're basically a technology bank. But beyond that, which is common knowledge, those who watch your stock have noticed there has been great improvement in the stock performance, and you basically tuned, overhauled the whole investor case, a profile of Sberbank. What was that and how you can describe it?
Thank you for this question. So it's nice to receive this question after the question about macroeconomy in Russia. Definitely, last year, 2015, was quite difficult for us. We started the year at a very low level. We were punished a lot for some issues we had on the balance sheet, and because of Russian macro and interest rate hikes, so all the steps and all the events we saw on the political landscape and macro landscape in Russia. And you all know that banking is always like a macro play, and Sberbank specifically is mostly traded as a proxy to Russia. That's why if macro is in trouble, then banks are in trouble too. And we tried hard really to have very open, very transparent discussions with our investors, explaining what are the tools, how we can navigate through this crisis, how we can manage it, what are internal reserves that we can use. And this was there was a message that we sent, not just from IR, our management was involved. Our CEO is very often exposed to meetings with investors, and he is very, he welcomes a lot this communication. He has become very open in the way how he speaks to investors, and not just here in Moscow, but he also travels a lot. As well as the other management team. And I would say, a turning point last year, we had the big investor day in London that we organized in October, and we presented our view on the new strategy until 2018. We have this conversation with investors before, but then when all this turbulence came in, so we decided that we need this discussion one more time. And we updated it a little bit, but still try to show what are the tools, how we can manage the bank internally to fix the problems and to use opportunities in operational efficiency, in technological breakthrough, in cultural development, in order to fulfill the targets that we set to ourselves a couple of years ago. And you know that actually the market turned out to believe to this story, and definitely there were a lot of skepticism about the targets and ability to perform all these goals, to achieve all these goals. But at the end of the day, we saw that, and actually at the end of this big event, we have web online access to this event. We have more than 150 investors in the room. More than 700 people were watching us through online channels. We tried to be very open and had very extensive Q&A session afterwards, had 6 members of the management board with us. And at the end of the day, the stock went up by 7%. So no one could imagine that actually impact can be that strong. Then everybody anticipated, consolidation in the stock price, but we haven't seen it to that extent. And then we continued with this communication, with one-on-one meetings, with NDRs in different countries, in different regions. And actually, this belief then supported by financial performance, because every month we started to deliver on the goals that we presented in the strategy. This confidence has increased. And now Sberbank has finally traded over 1 book value, which was, so when Sberbank was traded below 1 book value, it was always my pain. So the CEO was always asking, so why my IR team cannot re-rate this stock finally, so that the valuation is so low. So now we are quite satisfied with the way how market has received this message. And what we are doing, simply we developing these communications using new formats. Before our AGM, we launched our application. Mobile application. Now we are completing.
For electronic voting?
No, this is just about IR app. IR app, we haven't, for long time, haven't had this nice tool, and the confidence actually, when we discussed it with investors and with sell side analysts, they were quite skeptical whether we need to invest time and efforts to develop it. But now we see that actually the results are quite good. And people do really like, they use them, we can track the usage, and we think that we need to develop it further, because there are plenty of other features that we can include in this thing. That's why this digital communication, which would allow us also to be more transparent in our results, to present more information about what Sberbank is doing. We are quite open, you know, that we report on the monthly basis and receive all the questions from all the market on the monthly basis, but it will be much easier also to deliver like even weekly analytic for those who is interested in.
Okay. Thank you very much. With that, probably we move to discussing the technology in social media in a way that was interesting introduction for Steve. But before that, I have still one small question to you. You're one of the few companies which announced ambitious investor relations programs, like the strategy of the bank for several years. And you mentioned that each quarter you show the progress against the strategy and delivery. How you do that? I mean, is it you include a slide in your quarterly financial presentation where you say, and now one slide about the strategy delivery. In this quarter, we have done something like that, open that, reduce the cost or whatever. Or is it you have launched, I don't know, a webinar on the strategy delivery specifically? How, I mean, from the communication standpoint of view, how you are keeping your investor updated on the strategy delivery, if you can share some tips with us.
So obviously, on regular basis, quarterly, on semi-annually, we show whether we are on track with all the targets. But honestly speaking, if we talk about strategic goals, this is not something that would need like a short-term update. If we have this conversation,
basis,
yeah,
right?
on an annual basis is much easier. What we also have started to do already a couple of years ago, this is like annual guidance. We have defined set of indicators that our investors are interested in, which really contribute to understanding of our model, what we can achieve, what kind of performance we can show fundamentally. And we agreed on these indicators. We discussed these indicators before when we complete our business planning, and also when we have any updates, we also deliver a respective communication to the market. And this has become like a goal after we completed SPO in 2012. Before that, we were like prohibited from giving the guidance to the market. But since then, it has become like a rule within the company that every year we provide the market with some outlook for 1 year. And then we can update it, we can adjust some numbers, because obviously 2014 was extremely difficult year, especially fourth quarter. But market really respects this approach, and we highly recommend if you have this feature and you can convince your management to support you in this ID, we think it's very useful.
Excellent. So you are the boss of the legal team, basically, because that would be the key obstacle in any company, you know, when you come with an idea of let's issue a guidance and they say you will be issuing a warning all the time once you are not delivering. And but it's great you're doing that. A lot of companies on developed markets are issuing guidance, probably not in such a cyclical industry as steel and mining. Maybe you are much more resilient with your financial quarterly performance, because in our case, you have ups and downs all the time during the year. It's very difficult to have even a consensus view for the year for EBITDA. Exactly. But let's leave it a specific question. So with the technologies, I think, again, Sam, to you, and then we move to Michael and Steve. Steve mentioned in his presentation that conventional, it becomes even conventional social media. You know, it's such new, but it already becomes conventional. This YouTube, this Instagram, Facebook are useful, helping to build reputation, maybe reach to your customers, maybe develop your strategy, with the stakeholders and communication, but at the same time, it's still not popular with the investors. They are still using conventional platforms to get information like Bloomberg, Reuters, something like that. They refer to apps of the companies, to the websites. And in this relations themselves, it's like one-man show, as you mentioned, and we'll talk about what the size of an investor relations team should be and with the duties. But let's not talk about conventional media. And EM is a very, very active user of social media, and we are seeing your pictures all the time, which cheer up us because it's all the time amusing, and thanks for that. But at the same time, let's talk about online platforms. New community groups like Elite Platform Connect, which is London Stock Exchange is developing, Close IR is developing, which is a very interesting project, which will, I can remind you of some of who don't know, that will be a huge investor base in a social network where you can basically communicate within this platform in a closed environment, protected environment with the investors, build your schedule and answer their questions. So it's basically like a messenger, like a LinkedIn profile, right? With the right people, talking with the right people around the clock and those who are really interested in you. And that has a very personal communication. So how are you seeing this trend? Are we all moving into this? Or, with all respect to such platforms, one-on-one meetings, real face-to-face meetings will never be replaced?
Well, I think face-to-face meetings can never be replaced entirely. But I think that the current state of social media as a channel for investor relations is quite poor because it wasn't designed with investor relations in mind. And at the end of the day, they are simply channels. They're a way of delivering content. And if you have content that is interesting and attracts people's attention, that you can distribute through those channels, that's excellent. But there are very few companies that really develop specifically kind of social media-minded content for the investor relation purposes. And where, you know, things start to become much more interesting is when we talk about video not as, you know, okay, you have a YouTube channel, do some interviews with your CEO, but when you talk about video from the, you know, the channels are all very clear and are all there. But it's how do you make an interesting video that is not just going to be a 10-minute or even a 5-minute Q&A session, but that will entertain people, that will get them, maybe there's just 3 or 4 sentences of somebody speaking in the entire video, but it will have, you know, I mean, I'll sit and watch a helicopter flying over an open pit mine just because it's an impressive shot. And then you add some information to that, and you start getting bit by bit, building up, attracting people's attention and building up their knowledge of your company. And then you use the channels to distribute that. Virtual reality is another new type of media that I think we'll be seeing more and more of very soon. Think about trying to get Ira, my colleague, and I were just discussing how it is impossible to do a site visit to many of Rosneft's, for example, sites, because it's either minus 40 or you've got mosquitoes that are nearly a foot long. But send a team out there with a camera, have them walk through with a virtual reality camera, and then send around Google Cardboard envelopes with your company's logo on it and a link to the virtual reality tour. And these guys can just go on their mobile phone and walk around the site, see it. They can just take their iPad and kind of just hold it in front of them and look around.
Some Pokemons.
You can. We were thinking about how to include Pokemons in the thank you very much.
It's very risky.
The point is, you need. There's so many. There's so many more ways to deliver to create interesting content now, and virtual reality is a very, very interesting one. The platforms, I mean, Closer, Tom Blackwell and I are both investors in Closer, so we kind of absolutely love them and support them and wish them the greatest success. But that is one of the first platforms. It is sort of like a social media, but developed specifically for investor relation needs. And it's answering the kind of the demand from the market as companies and investors want more direct access to each other without the middlemen. But they also need the information in a kind of convenient format for them and kind of everything in the same place. And that's what Closer is focusing on, is helping to bring people together, specific features that are designed for an IR professional or for an investor to meet their needs, not Facebook or Twitter, where it's there's so many great functions, but it's not what you need as a professional. So
right, I mean, on Pokemon, seriously, the last board meeting we were like for an hour discussing Pokemons, because we don't want those fans of the Pokemons catch them inside over fences of our plants, industrial plants, risking their lives and violating our security rules. So it's a real problem at the board level of Severstal, discussed just several days ago, Just a small remark. With that, moving to Steve. You mentioned in your analysis that investors complain that Russian companies don't often take their CEOs and CFOs to roadshows, and it's mostly investor relations coming. It's definitely 4-hour flight to London, it's different time zone. So it's, difficult logistics compared to someone sitting in London, in a British company. It's like you move across the street and you see the investors. To what extent, connecting that to what Sam just said, would virtual reality, some webinars with the CEO, CFOs from Moscow, digital, whatever, will be some sort of replacement? Or they want to see them physically, look into the eyes, ask difficult questions they would never ask once online, on the public? So what do you think?
I think at the moment they're really... Rightly or wrongly, there is a belief in the market that you need to meet face to face, and you need to shake hands and look the person in the eyes, etc. There's been a lot of attempts, and virtual reality is very interesting, and obviously there could be a lot that it could do in the future. But telepresence, for instance, has been going, 7-8 years now. A very much more effective way of video conferencing than the previous one. And there certainly was a big push, now it's about 5-6 years ago, from quite a few of the investment banks in London who had invested in telepresence facilities, and were offering that to for the buy side and corporates to connect up where they didn't have such facilities themselves. And there wasn't really much take up from it because of the desire to still meet face to face. Yeah, when you've met, when an investor has met a corporate a number of times, they're more likely to be able to accept a remote interaction as opposed to a direct one. You can argue about whether that's actually sensible, whether it's good use of time. And clearly, the buy side in particular is somewhat restricted in terms of the amount of travel they do. So the remote stuff should take off and be used more. But at the moment, it really isn't.
Okay, excellent. Yeah, please.
I'm sorry, but that I perhaps am too excited about virtual reality at the moment, and it may be a couple of years away. I agree. I mean, right now there is little take up, but we're working on a project, for example, this fall that will involve the first ever virtual reality broadcast of a chess tournament. And in describing how that's going to work, you start to understand how this could work in many other formats as well. When you have not just a broadcast of the video, but you have all sorts of other information overlaid on top of that. And so, you know, we were just trying to kind of imagine how this would work in an investor relations context when the necessary kind of infrastructure exists. But you can have 10 investors in 10 different cities sitting at their desks. They don't even have to go anywhere. They put the headset on, and they see a room with your company's management in it. They can look around the room back and forth. It's not just a stationary video. You can have the slides showing up on part of the screen, just right there, kind of in front of them. Or you can just have an information feed that's going across. And so I think that a lot of what investor relations is going to be about in the future, especially if you have more people and resources available, is finding the creative new ways to present this information that attracts people to you. And I mean, it sounds expensive right now, but that's not going to be expensive in 2 or 3 years, maybe 5 maximum. It's going to be much cheaper than doing a roadshow or doing a site visit. Yes, I absolutely agree that you need to meet face to face, but there are going to be much more effective ways of doing it too.
So. Excellent, thank you. I fully agree with you. So probably you will spend, as a new listed company, several years building face-to-face relations. Once that's done, the investors know you exist. You are coming year after year. Then you can switch to virtual reality. Probably starting immediately from virtual reality would be something for Silicon Valley companies. But maybe I'm too old-fashioned, so I don't know. But with that, with the new skills, new challenges, new expectations from investor relations, who should be now creative, who should be excellent TV presenters, who should be, I don't know, you know, like Elon Musk presenting themselves better than any public relations in their company and teaching their CEOs to be so creative, because most of our CEOs, CFOs in this country, very old-fashioned guys who are not behaving, you know, so freely as movie stars in the camera. They are sitting dull and reading through the paper. Not all, but there are some, you know, some examples. And this is probably what you don't want to show to investors and the rooms they are sitting with the portraits, you know, everything at the background. And icons, I don't know. I'm sorry, I don't have anything against that, but I mean, that will probably surprise Western investors. But moving to Michael. So small teams, 1-2 people, with a lot of challenges ahead. Are you seeing a trend where Steve mentioned that large companies are still running separately public relations, investor relations, and internal communications? But are you seeing a trend where there is, you've just made an excellent study, a global study, right? If I'm not mistaken, for 2016,
yeah,
investor survey. So can you share with us some findings? How are you seeing the investor relation function moving? Are you seeing it's combining new roles?
So our survey found that 66% of investor relations professionals are responsible for more than just investor relations. Only 34% are working purely on IR. So 22% are also responsible for capital markets, 20% for corporate affairs, and 17% for strategy. Surprisingly, only 8% are responsible for treasury, but there's obviously a clear crossover of roles there. I think this is maybe an issue for smaller companies where your time is going to be spread quite thinly. but you have your budgetary pressures mean that you're not going to be able to have a more diverse communications team. For larger companies, you may be able to split those roles in a more effective way and have an overarching communications professional able to take the wider view.
Now please continue with the question, which I will ask also Sam, on the KPIs for investor relations. I mean, it was great to see in the presentation of Steve that long-term value of investor relations is evident. You mentioned all the star companies. You know, long-term, they really deliver the value. You build a reputation, build a trust, and that starts working for you. So, but annual KPIs, what would you put that there, Michael, for us? It's like perception studies, investor feedback, analyst coverage and the quality of that.
I think there's a need to balance inputs and outputs. So obviously you need to track your contact with investors, the number of meetings, the number of phone calls, your engagement with the investment community. But then it's also important to track the outputs. So our survey found that whilst 52% are using the number of meetings and calls held as a KPI, 26% are using the correlations of those meetings and calls held with the performance of the share price and with the purchase and sale of the stock. I think the major trend is that analyst and investor feedback is still predominantly the major KPI. 90% of companies are using analyst and investor feedback as their KPI. And 68% are using shareholder-based development as a KPI as well. Internal feedback makes up 63% of feedback of respondents using it as a KPI. And at the lower end, you have share price volatility, only 14%. And I think that's probably fair given the market environment.
And non-perception studies, I mentioned that's the primary KPI. How often do companies do that during the year, and mostly when? Is it for the head of the AGM to provide to the board and the top management? After the AGM, after financial results reporting? So what would advice would you give us? I know each company here in the room has its own tradition of making perception studies, but what would be your advice?
Give me 1 second.
Sure.
Come back to me.
Yeah, absolutely. Sam, in the meantime, maybe you can share some of your ideas on the KPIs and perception studies, as mentioned, to start with.
Well, I think the I think we have kind of the main KPIs that are fairly standard across companies covered already. I think that when you look at Russia specifically, it's often a more complex environment that you're dealing with, and different companies, because of the situation they're in, may be more able to achieve certain of those KPIs, maybe less able, you know, just because whether it's a economic cycle, sanctions, political exposure, whatever. You have to be a much more kind of sit down with management and be able to look through. Here's what our company strategy is over the next couple of years. Here are the kinds of issues we expect to be coming up, and this is how we want IR to be able to support our company's goals, in addition to the fairly standard set of KPIs, actually find some more customized ones that fit specifically with the company's needs. And it's very much up to the judgment of company management often to decide how you've performed against those KPIs. That's, I think, one of the key areas to go.
Okay, thank you. So back to Michael, and then I will ask Alexandra, how often does she get these questionnaires from Russian companies asking, please let us your view on us for our perception study? I guess so many companies in Russia, so you should be having a lot of job. But Michael, first to you.
So surprisingly, we found that 19% of companies aren't tracking perceptions, which I thought was quite a shocking number, really. 34% are conducting in-depth perception studies on a regular basis, mostly likely an annual or biannual basis. But most frequently, perceptions are tracked using brokers, using roadshow feedback or internal feedback.
Thank you. And Alexandra, what tips can you give us not to distract you too much from your work, but still get your feedback on the companies?
Well, basically, giving feedback after each meeting with the company is a kind of a courtesy. A kind of good way of doing business with the company. So it is never too much feedback. If the company is asking, you should give it.
Excellent. So we will spam you more. Thank you.
Okay. We're talking about companies, Russian companies from different sectors under my coverage, oil and gas, metals and mining and electric utilities, and my observation is that companies where the major stockholder is not a government, the question on the feedback, I receive more often question for feedback, actually. We're talking about metals, mining, and electric utilities, especially Russian companies, the question for feedback is not a kind of regular question, and it is more related to some kind of preparation for annual meeting, mostly.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. Anastasia, probably we are completing the panel, as Dima mentions to me, but would be interesting to hear your view. What's your experience of getting feedback from investors? What tips can you give us?
So obviously we ask for a proper perception study on annual basis, and it has been already, 5 or 6 years, so that we're doing, and we are able to track the progress, identifying some areas that we need to focus. So normally we do it at the end of the year before we start planning our activity for the next year. And this is very useful. Then we present this information to our board as well as supervisory board, so everybody is very interested what we have done right, what should be improved going forward. Perception study is obviously the outcome is used as a way to assess our progress and the way how we worked as an IR team, as well as a bank, as a management, because we have different sort of questions in there. If we talk about KPIs, so we've defined a very, I would say, standard approach, defining the plan for communications, for interacting with investors for the year, and then we have to deliver on this plan. And then we complete with informal feedback, with this perception study, to assess whether the execution was good or not that good in details.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. Dima, shall we give a couple of questions to the room, if there are any questions to our panel? Yeah? If there are no outstanding questions, Dima is suggesting to have questions during the cocktail break. Okay.
Thank you to all.
Thanks to all.
Thank you.